Trump answered some questions from a doctor, but he still won't say if he's had a negative test yet.
This, we do not know.
So he might technically still be contagious.
We're learning.
But he feels so good, he said, I may be immune.
What is this?
And now he's holding rallies.
Yeah, who does this?
Trump is clearly itching to get. All right, well, thank you very much for stopping by, Dr. Benotis.
Oh, no. While I'm here, I have to give you.
That's okay, Doctor. I'm in amazing shape.
Yes! And we noticed. Okay, well, I'm gonna do it anyway. Okay.
Thank you. Okay. What is going on?
I'm sorry, you guys. It's such a crazy time, and this is something I started doing.
We could not be contained, even as she was about to speak to the DA.
Today is Thursday, November 19th. Thank you for joining us. I am joined today by Dr. Janae Khaldoon, our chief medical executive, by Dr. Matthew Hornick, the president of the Michigan chapter of the American Academy of Pediatrics, Brian Torek, the co-owner of healthcare workers.
Michigan at this hour as articles of impeachment are introduced against Governor Gretchen Whitmer there over the state's plan to enforce more virus-related restrictions. Brand new hour here in America's Newsroom. Welcome. I'm Sandra Smith. Hi, Trace.
Sandra, good morning to you again. Good morning, everyone. I'm Trace Gallagher. Three Michigan House Republicans filing the resolution arguing Governor Whitmer's new limits on gatherings violate the constitutional rights of Michigan citizens, among other things. The article.
You got to get your governor to open up your state, okay? And get your schools open. Get your schools open. The schools have to be open, right?
Our livelihoods and our rights that we are born with as humans, we're not going to budge.
Would you turn to violence?
If my life was threatened, and my rights are threatened.
But the protection of lives means threat to livelihoods. Under the new restrictions, bars like Stephanie's will be forced to close. She doesn't have a safety net, and she's fearful and frustrated.
This should have been over. You know, we potentially could have not had these numbers. And do you feel quite stressed about it?
Joined local clergy and law enforcement in a unity march through Detroit.
It was organized by Greater Grace Temple to honor the life of George Floyd. Our Rod Maloney was at the march. It started in Highland Park and ended up on Woodward near Wayne State.
We have seen over the last week that many of the demonstrations have gotten violent, buildings burning, people injured and killed. Here in Detroit, we've not had that so much. But this rally today with many dignitaries is designed to show that you can rally and protest without getting violent.
It was the Black Church that invented the nonviolent movement and the peaceful protest.
One, two, three, Black Lives Matter.
Dr. King and those
who are healing. I'm frustrated too. None of us wants to be here in this moment, but we are. And we have to do the best that we can. I think about kids who should be at school and miss their friends.
From Saginaw, Flint, and Detroit, to Lansing, Grand Rapids, and Kalamazoo, people from Michigan added their voices to the nationwide chorus protesting police brutality in the wake of the death of George Floyd. Most demonstrations were peaceful, but some evenings turned violent. A Sunday protest at the state capitol ended with rioters causing thousands of dollars in damage. Vandals smashed windows and set fires in downtown Grand Rapids and Kalamazoo. In many communities, protesters were met with a heavy police presence.
Say his name! Say his name!
As tensions escalated, tear gas and rubber bullets were used to disperse crowds. Some journalists were caught in the chaos. A The National Guard was brought to Grand Rapids to enforce a citywide curfew Monday. Dozens were arrested over several days in Detroit. But in Flint,
in honor of those Americans and so many others, George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, Ahmaud Arbery, Botham Jean, Terrence Kutcher, Jordan Davis, Oscar Grant, Philando Castile, Freddie Gray, Walter Scott, Tamir Rice, Michael Brown, Eric Garner, Trayvon Martin. Any other names, members?
I'm going to do the album. Sean Bell,
Jordan Davis,
Freddie Gray.
Good morning, everyone. The justice and policing.
Are her neighbors, but they're also her protesters.
And we have also been protesting, so, you know, it's kind of awkward having to be in the protest, going out, we're like trying to, you know, support everyone, and then coming back in here.
50 cops.
Awkward and frustrating, they say.
She blocks us off so she can feel safe, even though it's hurting all of her neighbors.
This stretch of Wrightwood between Kimball and St. Louis and Logan Square has been barricaded and blocked by police to keep out protesters and keep the mayor's home safe.
I make no apologies whatsoever for that. We are living a very different time, and I've seen the threats that have come in, and I have an obligation to keep my home, my wife, my 12-year-old, and my neighbors safe.
Chicago Police Superintendent David Brown says residential protesting is illegal in Chicago and in Illinois.
No, protesting in neighborhoods is not legal. What we try to do is err on the side of First Amendment rights. And so we give a little bit of wiggle room there. We compromise, except for the embedded violence we've seen.
But Ed Yonka of the ACLU of Illinois says the tactic is concerning and appears to violate.
Raymond Lopez, one of the mayor's harshest critics. Now, for context, on the day of the conference call, Chicago had 699 arrests, mostly looters. 132 officers were injured. There were 48 shootings, 17 homicides, and Alderman Lopez accused the mayor of being underprepared as the looting spread, saying his ward had become a virtual war zone. Listen.
Half our neighborhoods are already obliterated. It's too late. We have to come up with a better plan because once when they're done looting and rioting and whatever's going to happen tonight, God help us. What happens when they start going after residents, going into the neighborhoods?
With their base. And to that, I've said, and I'll say again, good luck. The mayors are getting it done.
Kaylee McEnany. You called her Karen. Can you explain that?
Yeah. I think it's pretty straightforward. Look, what we've seen, and unfortunately what we're going to continue to see, is the Trump administration obviously thinks that they will score some political points by trying to demonize and make Democratic mayors, particularly women mayors, like myself, Mira Bowser, Keisha Lance Bottoms of Atlanta, Jenny Durkin of Seattle, they think that they're going to take us on and make us look bad because that'll score points with their base. And to that, I've said, and I'll say again, good luck.
COVID-19, and tonight the I-team follows the data in a little village in North Lawndale, finding blocks-long testing lines pervasive illness and unthinkable loss.
It breaks our heart, mostly because of the kids.
Sara E. Camarillo's children loved her stepfather, Margarito Lacero Mendoza. He worked two restaurant jobs until the pandemic closed them down, and he took a manufacturing job to make ends meet. In May, he got sick and died from COVID-19, and the virus spread through his family. When she tested positive, Camarillo sent her children to live with her sister for 2 months to stay safe.
It's horrible. My husband and I would just go see them through the window, and it was heartbreaking.
Her mother now pleads with people to learn from her family's loss. She says if people take it lightly, they're going to feel the pain. Village on Chicago's west side. In all, more than 3,000 people have died in Chicago. Illinois, more than 11,000. Nationwide, more than 250,000 dead. That is enough people to fill every seat in Soldier Field 4 times. Or put another way,
her companion would not comply with the rules before takeoff.
You shouldn't. At this point, we're like 2 hours behind. People have places to go.
Lauren England, who was on board and shot the video, says it started when a group of people were acting unruly after boarding. And she says she heard them complaining about masks and seatbelts. The ruckus causing the captain to take the plane back to the gate.
She began to then hit her in the face, punch her in the face, and at this point, everybody's like,
the town's police chief is calling the violence outrageous and appalling.
It all went down during a Black Lives Matter march. CBS 13's Marissa Perlman is live in Nevada City with more on what happened, Marissa, and why no one's been arrested.
Yeah, Tony, my town, not yours. That was the message from counter protesters to demonstrators right here
along Broad Street when this protest happened on Sunday. The violence and the harassment all caught on camera.
What started as a peaceful protest against police brutality in Nevada City turns tense and at times violent when counter-protesters showed up. Ryan lives in Nevada City and watched it all happen from a tea shop, the two sides clashing right outside.
Before long, we were surrounded. One group was on one side of the parking lot and the other group was on the other side.
Ryan says he tried to talk with a man he says was getting violent with an elderly protester. But video shows what happens next, when Ryan gets shoved and then a third person punches him in the face. Ryan walks away as the fights continue. In a statement, the Nevada City Police Chief Chad Ellis says three officers were present, but no arrests were made. We did speak by phone with one of the counter-protesters directly involved today. He didn't want to speak on camera, but tells us he's not involved with Back the Blue. He calls himself a patriot and says he showed up to defend his city from potential vandalism.
We don't.
Pull straight up!